Medical Association, Dr. Agarwal, distinguished doctor panelists on the dais, off the dais, particularly the foreign delegates to this conference. Good evening to all of you. Well, Dr. Agarwal rightly said that in the valedictory session, you don't have questions, you just listen. Secondly, and more truly, the judges don't like to be questioned. Despite all that, you all are free to ask me anything if I can be of any help to this august gathering of doctors and the experts from the field of environment. That concession I owe for the reason that, be you what you are not above the environment. Nature doesn't need you. You need nature to survive. I just listened to some of the distinguished doctors. See, we are already on the second stage. You know, all of you have been extremely kind to consider the means how best to treat your patients, which to my mind is a second stage. And you have defeated, and I hope you, none of you mind my being a little frank, you have practically defeated the theory of prevention is better than cure. Why don't we think of the causes which result in various kind of diseases which today you are struggling to treat and keep the common society to survive despite serious pollutions. Even for the water, you know, you can see the water dirty and you can leave it. But for air, you have no choice. You have to breathe whatever you get to breathe. And fortunately or unfortunately, you can see nothing except at best sometimes if the PM levels reach like they reach 2000. Of course, they may be visible to eye. But in Delhi, I think still there has to be a day whether and where PM 2.5 or PM 10 was within the limits prescribed. Now see, I'm happy that Dr. Kushetra has filed that application. According to him, every child born in Delhi is going to be asthmatic within 5 years of his birth. If we are giving that to our children, are we fair to the concept of intergeneration equity that is being talked about? Gandhiji said, you must give the planet Earth to your generation in a better condition than what you received. But we are only adding to everything in negative terms. If you will think that we are talking about, not just now Mr. Singh spoke about the data being collected. Frankly, I don't know why we are collecting data. For what purpose? Don't you know that the air Delhi is polluted? You have 6 stations, you will have 26. So what? Is that the remedy to your problem? In my respectful view, no. We are totally directing ourselves in a wrong direction. You cannot and you should not go to the third stage, but I think you should remain at the first stage and stop and protect the very first causes of environment. If you are talking about air pollution of Delhi, well, there are two cities in competition, the Beijing and the Delhi. One beats the other. So I don't think it's a positive competition. Just look into, I just spell out some of the causes which we legally spell out, which we have totally from the practical knowledge we have come to know are what are the causes in Delhi particularly and all around the world. Because causes of air pollution do not change. And that is one great thing about environment. It knows no bonds. It has no restrictions. The air you are going to generate in one part of the country, one part of the world, is going to have impact directly or indirectly in the last part of the earth also. Now the Delhi, when we talk of pollution, you all will be surprised to know, when the odd even scheme was implemented twice over, the data collected and filed before the tribunal by the Central Pollution Control Board as well as by the DPCC shows increase in bad quality. It shows PM10 increase, it says PM2.3 increase, and half of the time you don't even analyze the parameters of air. You know, everybody is worried about PM10, PM2.2 as if the air contains no other pollutants, which is factually wrong. You have elements present in the air, just now you heard, that you can have carcinogenic gases coming up from emissions which are burnt. Burning of plastic is one of the best way of killing a man, and which is being done more often than not in our cities. Reverting back to what I was mentioning was that there are primarily, from the case study of Delhi, there are 9 causes for air pollution. First, construction activity and carriage of construction material. Second, burning of municipal waste and other wastes. Third, burning of agriculture residue. Vehicular pollution, dust on roads, industrial and power house emissions, including fly ash, emission from hot mix plants and stone crushers, and the industrial pollution of emissions. These are the broad basis from where the air pollution is rising today. What attempt anybody has made, whether he is a policy maker, whether it is the health ministry, or it is anybody, what effort has been made to control these 9 basic factors? If you will control these 9 factors, you don't have to worry. You don't have to fix up the stations to know. You will breathe a good air. You know, one of the doctors, which if I don't recollect correctly, but he had exhibited on the net and the paper, if I mean, Times reported it, a heart from Himachal, lungs from Himachal and lungs from Delhi. One was pink, other was black. So if this is, see, these are the physical conditions. You don't need, you know, now we are talking of data-based, I fully appreciate that to plan out your projects for implementation or prevention, you do need basic data. But data should not become your obsession. Now, can you, any of you sitting here, including the experts, can you tell me how many drains are there in Delhi? Take it from me, nobody knows. No ministry knows, no administration knows, no pollution board knows, no corporation knows. If we don't know how many drains are there in Delhi, what are you talking about treating the pollution? It relates to water pollution. But sure enough, one of the most serious contributions to air pollution is the methane and other gases generated from the drains which are carrying on sewage, trade effluent, industrial effluent, and mixture of everything. If you go to the drain, you go to different colony. Stand there for 5 minutes. I don't think you need anesthesia. You can simply perform a surgery. And Dr. Agarwal is an advantage because his hospital is next to there. So what we are trying to tell you is that we have the necessity to look into the issues fundamentally. Now, another observation was made that we need to change our mindset. I don't agree with that also. You don't need to change your mindset. You need to revert your mindset to what India is known for. I don't know how many of you know that if you go to Meenakshi Temple in South, they have, and it was a surprise to me, till around about 4 years back. You know, there the manager of the temple probably knew that who I was and how was I concerned with environment. He took me beyond the temple and showed me two chakras. One was Bhugola chakra, other was Prakriti chakra. It was made 700 years back. And these two chakras show you what is ozone layer, what are green gases, how would you protect environment, three levels beyond the sea and three levels above the sea. What country in the world will teach India what environmental protection is? We used to worship trees and we still worship trees. We worship rivers. We worship nature. We worship sun. We worship moon, stars. Ultimately, environment is nothing but a component constitution of all these components. Therefore, please just get back to ancient life of India and your environment would be clear. You don't have to think in modern times. You just have to protect what your heritage is. If you follow those chakras, I don't think you need to have any data, any sophisticated materials to lead you to all this of today's. Now let's see. I just want to give you a hint about the value system which was prevailing here in Delhi in the bad days when we had to pass very drastic orders. And we are quite sure, and speaking for myself, NGT is one of the most hated institutions of the city. You know, somehow. But we take that criticism with a very healthy mind. Because we know at the end of the day, if directions are carried out, it will be for the benefit of the society and it will be a good contribution of an adjudicatory institution to the life of the people. We have the benefit of having expert members with us. Some of them are technocrats, some of them are environmentalists, some of them are professors, some of them are the people who have walked from Gangotri to Calcutta to know what is the quality of water and air in India. So it is that kind of a thing that what we need to do. Now kindly see, I'll just give you a little bit of statistics because I'm sure with the WHO people here and the doctors and environmentalists, you won't be happy until some statistics are given. Because that is a sense of our life today, that we should have a calculator, we should have a computer, we should have everything but the common sense. Now, what I would say is, now let's see. PM10 prescribed value, as you know, is 100 micrograms per meter cube. PM2.5 is 60. The recorded in Delhi was 1,690 and 885. It came down to 950 in October 16 and 590. we even thought the only way of bringing instant fall in air quality, making it better and controlling PM2 and PM5 was only spraying of water by helicopters, if the people were to breathe even for one day. But that is nobody's priority. Helicopters are meant for traveling of some people. They are not meant for public good. So we need to utilize those things for public good. We have to bring out, if you need a change in mindset, you need change in mindset in administration. Individual thinking doesn't matter. You may be very environmentally conscious, but what will you do? A place which generates 14,100 metric tons of waste per day. A single man or a single group of people can't do anything. So we need to be having a different administrative mindset to ensure that we clean the air. Let me tell you another thing. It's my belief, could be incorrect, could be imaginative, that it is not impossible to clean the Delhi air. Because we saw the change when we passed orders of prohibiting operation of the hot mixture plants. You know, there were 30 hot mixture plants operating on Noida border without permission of anybody and emitting anything and everything under the sun. If I was to give you the analysis of the gas samples collected by them, you would be shocked. Now, who was permitting them? The board was to control it. The society was to control it. The administration was to control it. Similarly, if you are doing the construction, you are doing metro construction, why can't you take precautions and ensure that nobody throws dust into the air so that somebody else living in the next house sort of inhales dust all the night and all the day? What will air filters do? Air purifiers, filters will get choked. And what will you do to them? So you need to hit at the cause and not wait for somebody to get sick and cured. I wish I could really sort of give you some examples of the cases that come up before us and which includes the medical profession too. I would think, which Dr. Agarwal told me, that I would definitely advert a little towards the contribution which your profession can make. See, there are two professions in our society. One is the doctors, other is the advocates. If you see, both of them have a direct nexus between the policies of the country and their implementation by the society. See, to a lawyer, if our client goes and that lawyer tells him, look, this particular court is good or this particular court is bad, he instantly believes it. Similarly, a patient goes to a doctor. Now he tells him, look man, you are at the go point. So he shivers in his spine. Okay, doctor has said, I'm going. What you tell him to take preventions way within the maximum. That is what the lawyer will do, that is what you will do. You will tell him, look, if you want to look after your health, I advise you these measures to be taken. Having this broad concept, I think you can contribute a lot. I'm not sure whether in terms of making money or not, but certainly in terms of contribution to the social life of your country, because you can advise them how to be preventive rather than curative. To my mind, that is a fundamental function the science of medicine can play, a very constructive role in our social lives. Second thing where the doctors could cause and help, and I don't think particularly the associations like this or, you know, other medical professions, is don't fear making recommendations, including criticisms, for implementation to the authorities. If you find that some orders passed by some court, some tribunal, and some administrative decision taken by the government or the executing agency or regulatory agencies are somewhat unfair to human health, you should be bold enough to take up as a cause. I think that would be another contribution that your profession can make. I surely can't comment on how should you treat a cancer patient or how should you operate prostates. That's not my business. But I only would see a general parameter on which I think the profession of medicine, because I would call it a very noble profession, they are the only second person for a patient. You know, he prays to God and looks to you for treatment. I don't think there can be any greater compliment to a profession. If that be so, then you have to improve your advisory role, which is more preventive in nature rather than operative or curative and making a man spin. So that's all I think I could say on your lines. The other thing which lastly I would say the profession of medicine can do is you must give. Now I tell you, for example, I was shocked today, I'm coming just from after passing a very bitter order. You know, Medical Council of India, we had directed them to participate in checking up all the hotels, all the hospitals in the country, in NCT Delhi, and advise the tribunal what is the appropriate steps to be taken which are preventive. Again, I'm using the word very carefully. And the gentleman didn't have the time to participate. So today we had to pass some switches against them. But what I am saying is that today the courts are very open to accepting the professional advice from good bodies who have a social objectivity and have a goal or object to achieve. So don't adjust the goals to your desire, but you need to adjust your steps to reach the goal. The goal should be to clean the environment. And Delhi air is certainly cleanable. It improved tremendously after there was, but you feel bad when you have to pass orders like 50% of the corporation staff will be on the road. 50% of the police will be on the road. They should check out that no construction is done without covering the construction material. You know, this is not required. This should be what I call consciousness of the society. People should be conscious. They should tell, yes, you will not leave dust in front of my house, no matter who the hell are you. That is the approach we need to take. And once there is a social interaction and acceptance of normal standards, take it, things will improve. There is no question that you will be forced to breathe the air which will land up, you know, anybody. You know, the small children, I mean, what are we living in? I have my Mercedes car, I have a, you know, seven-star Audi or something of the kind. My child can sit in that car, but he can't come out and play. Because the moment he plays, next thing is to a pediatrician. And next step is, give him antibiotic, give him this, don't let him go out. We don't have to give this to our children. We need to give them a better life, a better environment to breathe. And I'm sure a lot of constructive suggestions will come out of these brilliant minds present here. And I would request Dr. Agarwal that if you have any suggestion, please feel free to send it to us. We will try to adopt it as far as possible. So with that, and I don't want to refer to the statistics of death, but anyway, Dr. Agarwal, you can circulate this if you wish to, it has a soft copy and I will send to you. So with this all philosophy and talk, I thank all of you for having given me an opportunity of talking to you, the brilliant people, and I hope that every person you touch under your treatment cures to your satisfaction and praises you for a better life and a better air quality, not only in Delhi, but all over the world. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Jesse.